you very much. And I think huge respect to Ola and Paulina for this show. I'm completely blown away with what they've done, so a round of applause for them. Well done. And then also, I have to be quite honest, I'm surprised you all stuck around, right? I'm the South African guy talking about CEOs at the design conference, so thank you for staying a little bit longer to listen to me. Much appreciated. So, but I do think there's relevance, and there's a reason that I'm here to talk to you about it. Because of my past, and because of what I'm doing now, and my team that I'm seeing over here, and the things that we're doing, and also just listening to some of the conversations and some of the presentations, I think this is something that we need to think about. And let me get to the point. So, my name is Werner Puchert. I didn't always wear a tie. This is in better days. I originally come from TBWA in South Africa. I used to work in advertising. I was the strategy director for TBWA Tequila. I made it onto the board of directors. I was really important. My name was on the letterhead. And I mean, when I listened to Irene and Anton's presentation yesterday, you kind of get to a space in your career where you go into a lot of meetings and you don't get to do the work that you want to do. So less UX, less design work, but more meetings and meeting with clients. So at that stage, I thought, what am I going to do? Am I going to jump out the business? I want to get back to the game that I'm in. But I started thinking about, and someone mentioned yesterday, if you do something that you're not enjoying, I mean, actually Romek said it yesterday, if you have to reformat banners, find a reason to do it awesomely. So I wanted to start to understand what it is when people connect with people who run businesses. So my talk is really about the C-suite. So what do we refer to as the C-suite? These are the senior executives, people who run businesses. Now, usually at the agency level, what happens is that you work with a client, and that's a brand manager or a marketing manager. You do work, you present it to them, and then they take your work to the CEO and screw it up and not present it well, or you go with them to the CEO to present that, and they buy the work. And for me, it's really about how can we connect with the CEOs, and I'll give you a reason why I'm thinking this is changing and why we as designers are getting into the boardroom. So the reason for my talk, or the title of my talk, is breakfast, right? So this is a little story I have to tell, but before I get into that, when you're a user experience designer, there's three things that you have to think about. There's user needs. And we kind of get really involved in that, right? Then there's context, where things happen. And a lot of people, and I was in UX Poland recently, they kind of leave things there. What is really interesting is to understand what happens on the business side. So it doesn't help that you do all kinds of stuff for people, all posters, do design work, but it doesn't answer to some kind of business need. And that's why I started thinking about this whole connecting with business people, trying to understand what they do. If you're an information architect, for instance, working in the UX side, you have to understand the politics within the organization. And I'm sure if you're an agency as well, when you do stuff for a marketing manager, sometimes they're a bit sensitive about what someone else does in the business. You kind of have to be sensitive to those things. But now, why did I do this whole breakfast thing? So when I was the strategy director at TBWA, I worked for one of the top four banks in South Africa. Now, banking in South Africa and the banking in Poland is kind of the same thing, right? It's very powerful corporations. They know what they're doing, they deal with government, they have some kind of influence on the economy, and they're always in the news. And like I said, one of my top clients, and the brand manager at TBWA was actually the daughter of the CEO of one of these banks. I never got to meet him. And the one day I was walking with her, we had a cup of coffee, we were talking about work, and around the corner I went, and here's this guy. Hello, Daddy. And he invites us over to go have a sit down, and I thought, this is my chance. I'm gonna meet the CEO of a bank, and I'm gonna tell him about how awesome I am. And then this happened. I couldn't say a word. I don't know what to say to this dude. I couldn't say anything intelligent around business. I had nothing to say. I was hitting a sweat. I was scared I was drinking coffee, it was gonna shoot up my nose. And it made me think, I really had to change my game plan. And since then I left agency, and I joined Deloitte Digital. And you've probably seen the Deloitte Digital stuff around and all the logos. So what does Deloitte Digital mean? So if you are in the agency world and you kind of know the Omnicoms of the world and the WPP, the CEO of WPP recently said their biggest competitor is going to be their auditors. And the team sitting in front here are kind of a proof of that. Because what is Deloitte doing at the moment? They started a small subsection called Deloitte Digital. They went out and started talking to creative people. And a lot of creative people, UX, design people, a crazy advertising guy joined us 2 weeks ago. And they are starting to build capabilities that all agencies have. And this is making agencies nervous as well. The challenge for us who are going into Deloitte is that Deloitte doesn't work at the level that normal companies work at. They have relationships with the top brass of this company, so with the CEOs, all these things. So people like myself and my colleagues are going into these boardrooms and we are presenting to people about the work that we do, the design work, and I'm talking design as a broad term, right? And I'm going to explain to you guys why I think that is important, why we are starting to have these conversations. One of the biggest reasons that we are going into the boardrooms is that the future is foggy. People actually do not know where the whole business model is going to go. They think they have the answers, and you've probably heard buzzwords like this before. Digital disruption, change by design, communication is going to change the way that business is going to happen. But the top CEOs in these companies are unsure where things are going to go. They're nervous. And I'll give you an example of that now, why these business models are changing. The fact is, however, that they're turning to us, the design community, to help them navigate this uncertainty of the future. The reason for that is that we have tools, we have knowledge, we've got some experience in the crew to kind of navigate and figure out how these things work. And I'm going to give you an example of why I'm saying so. And this is one of the classic things. I'm going to try and not show too many graphs and things, but this is one of two. So if you had to look in the past, in 1980, right? This is probably before most of you guys were born. When you wanted to go on a holiday, right? You phoned up an agent, or you went into a shop to go talk to a travel agent. And this travel agent will then go and book a trip for you, right? Then digital happened. So then companies like booking.com, a good friend of mine worked for them for a while, kicked in and things like this started happening. So at the top, you still have your consumer, you go into a blog, you start reading about, you know, this holiday you want to go on. A lot of the articles that were written on these blogs were done by amateur journalists, so they knew what they were doing. But then you went to an aggregator like booking.com, found the best prices, and then you go on your trip, you go to the hotel. The next level of that, of course, is the social age. TripAdvisor, good example. And these are still going. I'm not saying anything is irrelevant yet. TripAdvisor is now content is being created by us, the collective, right? So you go in, you can comment, you can, you know, I'm going on a certain holiday because someone recommended it. I mean, restaurants, for instance, when you go to a restaurant, you go eat there, you look at the ratings. TripAdvisor is the same thing. But then you still go to the aggregator, get the best price, and then boom, you go on your holiday to the hotel. And this is where disruption is starting to happen, and this is also why people like myself and my colleagues are going into the boardrooms to talk to CEOs. Now look at this model. Now we all know Airbnb, right? You probably have been on a trip. My first trip to Poland was an Airbnb trip. Ended up somewhere in an old town, stayed in a nice little place. I didn't even look at a hotel. Consumers, crowd commerce happens. You find a place to stay. Someone else is hooking you up with a house. Big challenge, there's no hotel there. Same is happening with Uber. No taxis, it's driven by the community. Is taxis irrelevant? No, it's still there, but the business models are changing. And this is also where we come in with the whole model of disruption. And this is why companies want to talk to us, because someone needs to help them navigate this. But it's not a new model, a new concept. So, this is an old guy from IBM, Jay Watson, and he said, good design is good business. And this is the last graph I'm going to show you guys, promise. So what a company did is they went and looked at all the businesses who are design-centric. and they actually mapped them against the S&P 500 index. So to explain to you how this works is that if you are a normal investor, right, you will probably look at the gray graph and you'll invest your money there, normal S&P index. What this company did is they looked at the companies like Apple, Nike, Coca-Cola, Starbucks, Walt Disney, a whole bunch of them that actually focus on design, and actually mapped them out as well. So if you took $10,000 and you invested in one of those companies, you would have made 290% profit. Now, not as exciting for people like us because we want to win awards, but when you start talking to CEOs and to stakeholders, shareholders, that is the stuff that starts counting. So I usually throw this slide into a conversation when I do a presentation to clients. But then let's talk about the less sexy stuff. So I thought I'll challenge myself and look at some of the companies that are probably less sexy than Apple and Nike and think about what disruption does for them. So for instance, Walmart, they brought in a bunch of designers, UX designers, to relook their e-commerce sites. And after that exercise was done, their e-commerce went up by 200%. I mean, for people who run business, that is serious increase in revenue. John Deere, the disruption that happened there is that, I mean, in the old days, they sold farming equipment, right? So, and they still do that. But then what they're doing now is that they're actually supporting all this through content, through helping people understand farming, soil quality. So they're building the whole business around content and enhancing the whole experience for their clients. And they're still selling the products, right? Gumtree is an example I wanted to put in. It's something I personally worked on, so I still do work. Gumtree approached us in South Africa to help them. So they're part of eBay, and I think there's a Gumtree in Poland as well. So what Gumtree asked us to do is, in South Africa, we have a population of 51 million people. 10 million of those people have access to the internet through smartphones or desktop access. And those are the guys who put their stuff online and they actually sell it, and it's great advertising and revenue opportunities for Gumtree. The challenge is that in South Africa that a lot of people have access to the internet through feature phones, less or dumb phones. So what my team did, the UX team and our technology team, we took all the Gumtree stuff and we made it and forced it to work on feature phones, optimized photos, looked at the user experience, and what we did is we actually opened up the whole experience for the broader South African market, so anybody can go and post their stuff. Their traffic went up phenomenally. They opened up their whole service and solution to a whole bunch of new people, so we created a new market for them, and that is done through design. So a lot of conversations led by myself and my team, talking to eBay directly, getting the stuff done, and getting the code out, getting the interfaces tested and live, and this is the actual model. So guys, we're going to the boardroom. It's a fact. I'm having conversations, my teammates having conversations with people. The only thing is I don't look like that anymore when I go into the boardroom. And the rest of my presentation is really about a few tips and a few things that I've learned going into these and talking to these people. But what I'm not going to do is talk down to you, right? So our parents taught us about humility and respect, something that you need to understand. The other thing is the dress code. I mean, I'm not going to talk to you guys about dress code. The one thing I've learned is that when you go into these meetings, it's about authenticity. So I don't wear a suit when I go talk to a CEO, but I make sure my hair is clean, right? So the thing is, we tell you authenticity and understand you know what you're talking about. It's not about what you look like. And I can speak about this from the heart. So the tips. My first tip is reconnaissance. And I've got a bit of a cat obsession, right? It's really making sure who you're going to be talking to in this meeting. So the first thing we do, and this is actually something that I learned from the Deloitte people, is do your homework. Now, as designers, we're not that interested in homework, so I've got a bit of a shortcut. And I found this little solution to help you guys out. So when you go see or go talk to people in banking or in retail, go look at this model, for instance. The first thing is that you need to look at what is the industry dynamics. Because when you go talk to a CEO, he's looking at the big picture. He's looking at the huge problem. He's not too worried about what we're going to do, but we need to have the right conversations with him, right? So what is the industry dynamics? What are the competition? So if you're going to talk to a retailer, let's say Bedronka, for instance, I mean, I don't know the retail space that well, you want to know what Aldi is doing, you want to know what's happening in that business, you kind of just get a feel. So reading a little bit up on the internet, seeing what guys are doing, look at the annual reports. The other thing that you need to look at is influence of suppliers. Who's supplying them? So if there's a problem in Germany, you know, they need to get stuff in, just kind of take notice of that, right? Threat of substitutes is very important. That's something that you can easily pick up when you start looking at trends in the market, right? So, for instance, the Uber example, where taxis are getting a bit nervous about Uber coming in and taking some of their business away. Threat of new players. Is there a potential that people are going to come in and start a whole new business that's different to theirs? And then the influence of customers. So are people happy with the company? Are people happy in general with something like banking, for instance? So that's kind of the broad kind of sense. Next example I wanted to give you, we'll talk about, is the actual people in the meeting. So you go to your meeting request, you click on the names there, and you start stalking these people, right? So you really need to think about the audience that you're talking to. So for instance, all the C's, the CEO worries about the biggest set of the company, what's going to happen in the whole company. When you talk to the CIO, the Chief Information Officer, he's probably going to lean towards a little bit towards technology. So things like, is their systems antiquated in the bank? So when you start doing digital solutions for them, for instance, you need to keep in mind that this guy might be a bit nervous about the new things that you're going to bring in. The CMO, that's a whole different conversation to have, right? So recently we had a conversation with a company who wanted to change the perception of their brand. And the thing is, they were bringing in a C-suite guy from the UK. So what we're doing at the moment is to be very sensitive about what we're going to say to this guy, because first of all, you can read up a few articles on him, see what he's done, because usually what happens is he's probably been a CMO somewhere else. And you can start seeing what is his intention. Is he interested in digital? Does he believe in certain things? So kind of stalk them a little bit. So for instance, I have a good example of that happening. I'm not a C-suite guy, right? One of my teammates, Joanna here, the one with the bright top on, when we interviewed her, she walked into the interview very cocky, self-assured, wasn't dressed well for that meeting. Sat down and she said, "Werner, I know you're passionate about digital in South Africa. Feature phones, smartphones, and connecting to people. I've got an example of stuff that I'm kind of passionate about. Look at this video." And I'm going, how did she know that? But the other thing is, well, don't be creepy. Don't be creepy. The next one, so that was reconnaissance. The other thing that I'm really passionate about, and this is a comment from a mentor of mine, Jeff Parks, and he said, sell the process, not the idea. And I heard it yesterday with Anton and Irene. What an awesome presentation. And what this means is, and I've got the two cats there, is that you want people to buy in what you're going to do for them. You don't want to walk into the boardroom, and I'm getting to an example of that later, where you're going to show them some examples and try and do better than them. You want to go with them and try and find answers to the problems that they have. And the journey can work both ways, right? So usually I play down with humility. There's things that you can learn from these people. So you can sometimes be the big cat, because you've got the tools, you can take them on a journey. But sometimes the CEO is going to be the big cat and he's going to kind of show you a few things. Key thing for me when I go into these conversations, and I always keep this quote in mind, okay, let's set the expectations low. And this is something that you kind of hear sometimes in the good agencies, is that always undersell and over-deliver. Don't go in there making promises, because some of these promises sound awesome. And they might just buy into that, right? And then when it comes to delivery, you fail because you've overpromised. You've overworked your team. They can't deliver. They work late nights. They're grumpy. And you have to go explain to this guy why you can't deliver, or why the deadline's going to get missed. So rather start slowly. Then also, back to the idea I spoke about before, is don't go and present ideas. Now, this is something I heard it mentioned yesterday, and I was in this position a few times before myself. You try and be proactive. You go into a meeting with a great idea, and you start presenting, and you're trying to tell this guy how it's going to work, and you completely miss the mark. Their technology can't handle it. They're merging companies, and the companies can't actually afford doing the technology that you want to do. And in fact, when I started out as a UX designer, I worked for a bank for a little while. And what happened is this designed by a committee. You're working with a big pile of papers like this, and all the people are sitting around the table like this. All the CEOs and guys are waiting for you to present this new solution. and you start showing the first wireframes. And because it's such an expensive meeting, because all the people in the boardroom are earning a lot of money, so they need to add their little 2 cents to the thing. So it becomes a firing squad. They're going to nitpick and find problems with your solutions all the time. And I mean, it was horrible. It was a bloodbath because you have to explain all these things and then go away and redo all the specs again. So we try not to do that. So what we try and do is convince them that we want to work with them. Brings me to the next point. And this is a quote. I mean, rather than doing a normal Steve Jobs quote, I thought I would bring this in. This is Edwin Catmull. He is one of the co-founders of Pixar and now the president of Disney. And he wrote a brilliant book. And if you're kind of interested in the whole business side of things and you want to not read a business book, go check out Creativity Inc. He gives you like awesome tips and advice for creatives around the business side. And one of the quotes he had is like, Steve was a big believer in the power of accidental mingling. He knew that creativity was not a solitary endeavor. And this is a nervous, kind of an uncomfortable thing for some people to think about. The point here is that if you look at the way that Apple is building their new building, or what they wanted to do with Pixar when they had their new building, is they wanted to build it in such a way that people actually walk into each other and have conversations. And this is like the internal kind of thing. So designers talking to designers, engineers getting together. But we are taking it right a little bit further. We want to involve the client as well. Because if you take the client on the journey with you, the senior client, it becomes a really interesting thing. Because there is no such power as a client buying into what you're doing and then helping you sell that idea and getting the funding and getting the solution implemented. So that brings me to the point is that what you actually want is executive endorsement, and that is what we always try to get. We don't necessarily want to sell ideas, it's just to get the endorsement from the client to give us permission to go do the work that we want to do. Now, from time to time, I'm not saying the CEO is going to be in all the meetings, right? But having his buy-in and his power to go and talk to his staff, get it connected with the people internally, that's going to help you deliver the projects that you want to do. And this example I wanted to show you because it sounds like pipe dreams, right? So this is Jaco Oosthuizen. He is the CEO of Momentum Multiplier. And I know you guys have no clue who that is. It's a South African insurance company, and Multiplier is one of the loyalty entities within this company. It's huge. It's the biggest company in South Africa when it comes to insurance and loyalty. And we actually convinced him to come into a design meeting. This was just before the design meeting kicked off, and he was really relaxed. He was playing around with all the little toys because we bring him into space, we talk about innovation and design. And I snuck a photo of him, and we took him on a journey of design, and we didn't have any solutions, and we came up with some ideas in this workshop. And did we implement something after the workshop? No, but it actually turned into a whole new piece of business for us, and this guy was our champion, connecting us with more people in the business. And this is the proof that these things work. Third point, be Socrates. And this is the art of listening. So asking questions and doing the right kind of right conversation in the boardroom. And when I do this, I have this silly little video I'm going to show you just to give you an example of what I mean. There's no sound. Anyways, she's asking a lot of questions. And I think I'm going to skip this slide. Because this is basically me tap dancing in front of you guys now. So the whole thing was that she actually walked in. She was under pressure. She didn't have a presentation prepared. And she was starting to draw stuff for the thing. But everything she said was a question. And that's what we do when we go into the boardroom and talk to these guys. Ask questions. But the one thing that you shouldn't forget is to actually listen to the answers. And when you start listening to the answers and asking more questions, you want to try and instill curiosity. Because you want this guy to get so interested in what you do that he starts investing in you. The other thing that's really important is to understand the meaning. Because if you speak to a CEO or a CFO, for instance, the guy who does all the financials, he's going to say to you, I want to make more profit. What does that mean? Because profit could be a scary thing. Because profit you can get through cutting people's jobs, saving costs. So you really need to kind of get behind what it is that they're going to tell you. And the next level, I just want to share with you this quote. And I'll make a line or a parallel between what the word or meaning actually means. So this is Robert Vigante, another book that I can recommend to you guys when you look at the business side of design, is that changing the rule of competition by radically innovating what things mean. So, meaning, for instance, is if you look at the Walkman, for instance, the Walkman was tape deck that used to play, and half of you guys probably don't remember that, but then the iPod was invented, right? If you look at the Walkman and the iPod is a complete change in meaning. So there's a music store connected to it, you can download music, you can look at watch MP3s, so the whole thing has changed, right? So if you can understand the meaning, you can actually innovate, because after the iPod, the iPhone was a change in meaning. But then again, what happens is that there's only incremental changes, and that's where technology comes in. So always try to find the meaning of something, and that's where your little hook will lie, where you can bring the executives in. Next slide, one of my final points is just objectivity and looking at the bigger picture. The important point for me there is just building bridges. So for instance, an example that I spoke about earlier in the workshops was building bridges between people. The one thing that we have to be careful with, and this happened to me personally, I had a bit of a moment in the boardroom, is that the language that we use from a user experience perspective, from a design perspective, is that people aren't always going to understand what they're talking about. So make sure that you kind of bring it down to their level, and I say down, maybe up, but make sure that people understand what you're talking about. Some of the things that I currently look at is how do you create the bridge between executives? So if you start looking at the business canvas models, value proposition models, those things will also help you building the bridges between the executive C-suite and within the conversations that you guys are having. Next slide, and I understand this is a bridge that actually burned down in Poland. I've never seen a bridge burn down. My wife told me that this happened somewhere in Warsaw, is that never burn bridges. For instance, there's a few points around that. C-suite people move around. So if you go into a meeting with a C-suite guy and you don't like him and you say something, because I tend to get a bit emotional in meetings, keep toning down, because your next client a year down the line might be the same guy again, because he's moved from one company to another one. The other thing is that you might want to do business with the same guy again. So what happened to me, for instance, is when we finished the Gumtree project, they actually approached us to do another project for them. We went away, we did the proposal, we presented the proposal to the guy, and he wasn't too impressed with it. He wasn't happy at all, and he decided to go with one of the competitors. Was a bit unimpressed with this because we put a lot of work into this, but then I decided to phone the guy up and say, listen, Johan, I think we messed up. Can you at least give us some advice? So what he did is he actually phoned me back later when he had time, took me through the whole proposal, showed me what we could have done better, and he's still on our map, he's still someone that we want to do business with, and we actually retained the relationship, but also, as a team, we learned something new out of that. Now, in the end, just to summarize my 4 points, reconnaissance, stalking people, sell the journey, you don't want to sell all the stuff for free, you want to get into it, you want people to help you build these journeys, get the solutions, work with people. The third one is ask meaningful questions. Find the meaning so that you can start innovating and start working with them to find those new innovations. And then build bridges, don't burn them. And then finally, there's research that has shown that very few executives will invest in new breakthrough innovations. They will invest in innovations and breakthroughs when they are personally involved. Guys, thank you for your time. Thank you to Edmund's talks. And have a great week.